Bibles if you need to.
The book, to the book of Isaiah
chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1. And we all see the news, read the newspaper, watch the news on television throughout the week, and see what is taking place in our country, in our nations, as it pertains to a police and their interaction with African American, especially men of color, black individuals. We see that. We see the level of injustice. And we know that America has been struggling with the legacy, albeit that we have elected the first African American president out of 44 presidents that has been elected. We now occupy the White House, the first African American president. But nevertheless, there's still a legacy of racial injustice that is taking place. And sometimes people don't want to say anything about such behavior, and they want to silence you and then call you racist for saying that racism exists. They want to talk any form of racial injustice. They want to attribute that doesn't exist. But we see a middle-aged man running for his life, fleeing, and being shot 5 times in his back. We see a man, and only because irrefutable evidence came on the form of a cell phone video that he's charged. Other than that, he would not be charged. We wouldn't hear anything about the death. It would be just another man shot dead, and it's always that the police say that they were in fear of their life, and we saw that. We see where a guy not doing much on a sidewalk in Staten Island, and he's probably hustling to make bread for his family, middle-aged himself in his 40s, strangled to death, choked, and no value for life. Say he can't breathe, even when you have him down, he's still standing on his neck and his head, and succumb to his injury. And we see all of that all over, and now we see in Baltimore someone in police custody with broken neck and shattered a nerve, a spinal cord. And some of us will just divorce ourselves from it and say, well, it's those guys in the urban centers probably selling drugs and doing all different negative stuff because of the blind situation. Some of them don't have the option out. They don't have the opportunity that was opened up to some African American communities like us, who God has blessed because of the covenant relationship that we have with God, that our children don't have to take that path. However, we are living and worshiping right now around that situation, and we cannot just come to church and come in our own little cocoon and just shut up ourselves and say they are our thugs and they deserve what they get. If they don't, they should follow the law. But no one deserves a death sentence when it comes on to even petty crime. God don't even give us a death sentence. God is not in the form of stone them anymore. When a woman came the broader woman and caught in adultery, it was the custom, the principle of Judaism to stone her to death. And God didn't allow that. And so we must not think that because someone has the badge and a gun, he can just do wanton whatever he wants and no regard for life. You see, injustice is when one person abuses their power to take from another person the God-given intents and God-given things, a gift that God has given to them. That is life, liberty, dignity, and the fruit of their love and labor. That's what, in essence, is injustice. God has given us life. God has given us liberty.
Yes.
God has given us dignity and the blessings that the Lord has given us. And with your power, and we know that God has ordained the state. The Bible said, the police, the law enforcement, bear not the sword in vain. And so we are not against policing. Policing is good. It's there to protect and to serve.
Yes.
The Bible said the police, the law, he is not for the law. It's not for the law, the lawful, but it's for the lawless. And so we want our police coming to be protected. But at the same time, we don't want our sons and our uncles and our husbands and our fathers to face indiscriminate abuse by agents of the government. Many people talk about, whenever you talk about it, what about the black and black crime? Most blacks and black young men are themselves killed by fellow black young men. However, we are not paying taxes to black thugs and killers and individuals and drug barons. No, we are paying taxes to the state. And we have given them permission by our votes to elect and to put people into situation where if they carry a badge and a gun, that they do not come and abuse me in an unlawful, unjust manner. And so we pay into a system to protect us, not to abuse us and abuse our children. Not to be wondering that when we send our kids, it's far and bad for our kids to be bullied by other members in their community, by other lawless individuals, and probably harassed. But it's a totally different thing when the harassment and the bullying and the injustice and the killing and abuse is done by individual who is entrusted by society for their protection. It's a different thing. So don't talk about black and black crime when we are talking about police brutality. There's a time when we talk about black and black crime. And the church has to deal with black and black crime. The church has to go into those communities and talk to and deal with the issues in those areas that create such environment, that create such conflicts that have result and there's no resolution but the shooting and killing of black men amongst black men. Most white who are killed by blacks, are killed by white. So no one discuss about white and white crime. Okay, and so we know most racial group killing is done amongst themselves. However, so don't use that as an excuse when we talk about someone being choked to death. And then no one is held accountable. In the last 20 years in this country, 17 police officers have been charged with murder. And you want to say how much we're convicted of murder? Not one. None. But that this is stated in the San Francisco Sister Chronicle. Not one was ever convicted of murder, though they were charged. And so we see what happened over this weekend, that they have been charged. 6 individuals has been charged. And one man of them has been charged with the murder of this young man. But statistically showing, none of them are going to be convicted. And they say most of them are not even convicted of anything. Not even murder, but not anything. And so as a result, the police officers, whether or not they're white or black, whether they're Hispanic or Asian, there's a culture that takes black lives for granted. And you say, well, my children are not thugs, or my children are not walking on a certain job. However, when they see all black men as thugs, they're going to see yours. Yeah. Hallelujah. They're going to see your uncle. Yeah. Hallelujah. They're going to see us as a, you know what? They are all like that. And so if you don't take a stance, then you're going to have that system to continue.
ability to go forward until when you are the victim, when your family becomes the victim, when you have to mourn, and then you say, why didn't we say something? Hallelujah, as they say that they came for this group, they came for the Jews and we did nothing. They came for the Japanese, we did not. The fact is that you cannot allow the situation to come to your home before and say, well, it's in my neighbor's home, it doesn't bother me. No, you have to take a stance against injustice, against evil, and racial injustice and hate and racism is evil. God is love. God is not about hate for any form of hate. And so God has dealt with that in Scripture. We see that in Scripture where God has dealt with a nation. And so we see in the Scripture here, we're going to read here in Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1 says, and I can't go because of lack of time, I cannot give justice. But Isaiah was called a prophet mainly to the people of Israel. And through the course of this chapter, he's telling Israel how corrupt they are, the children of Israel, how corrupt they are in terms of the treatment of other people, of the fatherless, of the orphans. And so in society, don't people say, well, we are the black fathers, we're the holes. We are invested that yet if those who are vulnerable, the widows and the fatherless, someone has to defend them. We don't make excuse because the fathers are absent. Society knows that these are vulnerable. You don't take now those people who are vulnerable and still abuse them because no one is there to speak on their behalf. And so God goes out, God makes special emphasis on us taking care of those who have been disadvantaged. God has always seen taking care of the poor and the needy and the widow and the fatherless. Fatherless orphan or those who don't never grew up with a father. Don't use that to say because they don't have a father, then it's their fault. No, it's not their fault that they don't have a father. Hallelujah. It may be the culture that they, but no child is held responsible for an absent father, whether if the father has died or walked away or abandoned. But it's for us as a society now to come alongside them and give protection and give and foster a sense of community involvement, not to allow other arms of government to abuse and take them for granted. And so God wrote in the scripture here, in verse 16 of chapter 1 in Isaiah, said, "Wash you, make you clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Seek justice." That's what judgment means. Seek justice. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. It means that we need to protect those that are fatherless or are vulnerable in our society. And plead for the widow. Plead the cause of the widow. And so we have to understand that the church has a responsibility. Hallelujah. God has used a minister, a man of God, a minister of religion, as the front line of the civil rights movement in this country over 50 years ago. And because he has used so-called raise up people from amongst the people. He raised up Moses to deliver people, his people, out of a bondage, out of slavery. So likewise, God has risen up through the church and through our black culture, someone to take a stand in a non-violent mannerism. We're not calling for taking up guns because we recognize violence begets violence, and all throughout history, revolution draws blood, and nothing in the end time. God may change. However,
that is toppled over. Toppled over. Even when you see one nation rise up, or one kingdom or emperor rise up, another kingdom come to take them. Violence never have an everlasting or long-term effect. It may last 100 years. Hallelujah. We will see the Babylonian Empire that swallowed up Israel in the days of Isaiah. But after the Babylonian, then the Persian. The Medes and the Persian. After the Medes and the Persian, then came the Greeks. After the Greeks, then came the Romans. Hallelujah. And we are still now living in a Roman revived empire. Hallelujah. And now part of that is now the American century, the American empire. And so we have to understand. But when you look at Daniel's prophecy, it says the stone that the builder rejected, he saw a stone that came and destroyed all the empires. That symbol, that Baal idol that was in Babylon, that was asked to worship. And that symbolizes that the church, through Jesus Christ, the cornerstone, is going to demolish, not through guns and violence and bullets, but through God's word, through the word, deliverance, through the Holy Spirit, the forces of evil. The forces of evil. And so we preach and we seek justice. We seek justice and we seek a peace, because what? Peace is of God. Righteousness of God, the kingdom of God is not meat, it's not drink, and it's not bullets, and it's not arrow. Hallelujah. The kingdom that God says, you see, if I was, God was for, he said when he was in the cross, if I wanted to come from him, he could have sent angels to come and fight for him. Hallelujah. He could have sent a barrage of angels. Hallelujah. But my kingdom is not of this world, he said. Hallelujah. His kingdom is a kingdom based on the Holy Ghost. Based on righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And so we as people of God, we who are the tree of righteousness, we preach. Hallelujah. As Jesus says in Isaiah chapter 61. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because the Lord God has anointed me to preach. That's what we do. God has anointed us to preach the word. Why he has anointed us to preach the word? He anointed us to preach the good tidings, the gospel, unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty. Liberty, that system of government tries to keep you and lock us up indiscriminately for mere things, mere simple stuff. Hallelujah. Most of our young men are incarcerated. Good men. Google could have given them education and be good citizens and productive citizens. Are locked up warehousing in our prisons. Hallelujah. Because someone took unjustly their liberty. Hallelujah. Don't do more crime than the dominant race. Hallelujah. The dominant population. But even in terms of drugs. But our 26 times more vulnerable to be incarcerated for having a little pot, a little substances. And we have to take a stand. That's why we come to preach the liberty. How the trouble is the liberty. Liberty. Hallelujah. Of the captives. And to open the prisons of them that are bound. That's what we're here for. Hallelujah. Yes, we get to sing praise and shout, but we are to preach righteousness to a crooked world, a crooked society. Hallelujah. Yes, this nation is a beautiful, wonderful, godless nation. But wherever you have evil, hallelujah, wherever money and capitalism is all about money, love of money is the root of all evil, the Bible says. And so when you have the system is said, I'm going to build prison more than I build school, so that some investor can invest in prisons, and we have these just instead of having rehabilitation centers and educational system and invest in the healthcare system, we invest more in penal institution. Hallelujah. To destroy our lives, the lives of our sons and uncles and fathers. And so we preach. We proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our Lord unto those that are mourn. And so God says, when we do such thing in verse 4, and then God shall bless that nation. the word of God is the, it says in verse 1, they shall build the old wastes. They shall raise up the former desolation. Bad neighborhoods, bad dilapidated cities. Hallelujah, shall be raised up and shall and form a desolation, and they shall repair the waste cities, the desolation of many generations. You see, it's the church. Somebody said the church, the local church, is the hope of the world. It's the hope of the world, not just in terms of spiritual things, but it's the church. I'm telling you, when God takes the church through the rapture and the Holy Ghost is leave here, that's when you're going to have the great tribulation. Because there's nothing to buffet evil. There's nothing to stop evil. And so you and I, sometimes even when we don't just, when we just be here by itself, is a buffer to the devil. Because it's the Holy Ghost. And but when we are here, we affect change in our cities. Desolate places, board of homes, and desolate evil. God has used us. And it wasn't for the local church. It wasn't for the black church. We don't know where our community is, would have been. And that's why God has protected us for centuries. Hallelujah. Through slavery and Jim Crow laws and all type of civil and lawless and racial injustice. God has protected his people because of the church. How do you say that? Because of the church. God has protected his people in Jesus' name. Come on, give God the praise. Come on, give God the praise.